All right, welcome to the second meeting of the Committee on Rulemaking, at which we're considering the draft recommendation on individualized guidance. I'll start with the roll call. I will call two rolls. The first roll will be the names of committee members and alternates of committee members. After each name is called, the person should say "here" so we can make sure their mics are working. The second roll will be the names of ACUS members who are not committee members or their alternates. After each name is called, the persons should say "here" so we can make sure their mics are working. I will not call the names of members of the public who do not have speaking privileges. All right, so let's call the roll. Laura Barhite. Laura? All right. Emily Bremer. All right, next, Peter Constantine or Heather Sokolower as alternate. All right. I know people are here, so eventually we'll get to somebody who's here. Tom Johnson. Sorry, did somebody say
something?
I'm
here.
All right, great. Thanks, Tom. Courtney Mallon for Chris Huey. Anybody see Courtney? All right, next, Nina Mendelson. Thank
here.
You. Thank you. Elena Ness.
I'm here.
Great, thanks. Nick Perillo.
Here.
Great. Ray Peeler. Ray, are you there? All right, next I have Mitch Plave. Okay, next, David Pritzker.
Here.
Hey, David. Lon Smith.
I'm here.
Hi, Lon. Kevin Stack.
Here.
All right, Jessica Stone.
I'm here.
Great. Tom Sussman. All right. I think the only person who's a committee member who is not currently here, but maybe here later, is Elizabeth McFadden from SEC. I think she'll be joining in a little bit. Okay. Are there any committee members whose names I did not call?
Okay. Nick Goldstein with SBA Advocacy. I'm very new, so probably don't have my name yet.
Okay. Thanks, Nick. So for non-committee members, Jeff Lubbers, Bill Funk,
here,
thank you, Matt Weiner,
here, thank you, Ben,
yep, Ron Levin,
here,
Tim Mullins, as alternate for Dan Cohen, okay. Are there any non-committee members whose names I did not call?
I'm sorry, I got my committees mixed up. I'm new.
Okay, that's okay.
Hurt me. I'm not on this one. I'm on regulation, but I was joining this one just to sort of get a feel for committee meetings.
Okay, yeah, that, no, that's great, Nick. Thank you. We got you. Okay. All right, I'll now turn it over to Committee Chair Bertrall Ross to explain the meeting protocols and continue with our review of the draft recommendation. Bertrall?
Great, thanks so much, Ben. It's great to see you guys. And welcome to our second ACUS Rulemaking Committee on Individual Guidance. I'll start by reading the meeting protocol and then we'll jump right into our discussion of the recommendation. So please note that only ACUS members, including government members, public members, senior fellows, liaison representatives, and special counsels, whether or not on the committee and their designated alternates, have full speaking privileges. To avoid background noise, though, I'd ask that you keep your microphone on mute and either use Zoom's hand raise feature or add a comment in the chat feature if you'd like to speak. I'll then call on you and you can unmute yourself. Please then remute yourself when you're done. I'd also ask that ACUS members and their designated alternates use a webcam to facilitate conversation. With respect to attendees other than ACUS members and alternates, participation requires the unanimous consent of the committee members. Time permitting, I'll consider calling on such attendees at appropriate points, and will presume that committee members consent absent their raising an objection. If any such participant would like to speak, please so indicate in the chat feature or by using Zoom's hand raise feature and wait to speak until I call on you. You can then unmute yourself and please remute yourself when you're done speaking. For all participants, please use the chat feature only to indicate that you'd like to speak, or for committee members and their alternates to vote when asked. Please do not hold any sidebar discussions or put substantive comments in this chat feature. Only members of the Committee on Rulemaking, including government members and their designated alternates, public members, senior fellows, liaison representatives, and special counsels have a vote. Please do not vote unless you're a member of the committee. We have a list of committee members in case you're unsure. So that's the standard protocol. So in terms of how we'll conduct the meeting, we'll conduct it like the last one. We'll work through recommendation by recommendation, starting with where we left off with recommendation 6. And I'll give you an opportunity to read the recommendation again, and then we'll open it up to discussion. We will try to reserve particular wordsmithing if it gets too much into the details to the Committee on Style, but we'll try to capture all of the suggestions with respect to changes to the recommendation here at the meeting. I just want to recognize Shalini Ray as the expert, expert consultant who wrote a great, excellent report on individual guidance based on research and engagement with agency officials. And so I will lean on her for thoughts when it comes to questions relevant to her report or her expertise on this matter. So without further ado, I'll have Ben put up the recommendation on the screen for everyone to see. And I assume that everyone sees it like I do. And so we'll proceed with rule recommendation 6, and we'll work through the recommendations, the rest of the recommendations, and we'll go back to the preamble is what it's called, right? A preface, whatever we use to label it. And then if there are any additional questions about the first 5 recommendations for which we went over last meeting, we'll turn to those at the end, time permitting. And there will be a break in the middle around the 10:30 mark to give people a chance to go to the restroom or whatever, do whatever else, other things that they might need to do. Okay, so let's start with recommendation number 6, and I'll give you a chance to read it. We'll go 6, A through G. And so I'll give you a little bit more time to read this, and then we'll work through any comments, both comments by Jeffrey Luber and any comments that you might have as well.
Yeah, and just to remind folks too, we did kind of go through recommendation 6, but the first thing we did was add, after discussion at the last committee meeting, a recommendation for agencies to publish their procedures in the Federal Register and Code of Federal Regulations, and this is reflected in the comment to the right. Just wanted to note that.
Great. Thank you, Ben. And I'll turn it to you, Lon, in one moment. Just give some folks a chance to read it through. Okay, so we'll start with Lon Smith.
Hi. I think, first of all, I'm sorry I missed the last meeting, but and I think publishing the procedures is a great idea. It helps the agency also. But why are we specifying exactly where they have to publish it in the Federal Register and the CFR? Why is that important?
Yeah. So this came up last meeting, in which it was a suggested addition. I don't know if I have it right. My memory might be faulty, but I think Nina was one of the folks that recommended this addition, and others as well. I think the thought was to provide instructions as to where it would be best to publish such procedures so that they're broadly accessible. The concern is that without such guidance, the publication of the procedures may not be in places that are the most accessible. I think that's the thought process, but please do chime in, Nina or others who propose this recommendation, if you so wish.
Yeah, well, while they're thinking about it, I mean, the IRS, go ahead. Somebody else has an idea?
Yeah. I had to leave for teaching, so I was not here for the CFR recommendation, but at a minimum, FOIA requires significant guidances to be published in the Federal Register. It seems like this, I think we should be indicating that this qualifies. I am not, so I think at a minimum, it needs to be in the Federal Register. I would support CFR just because the Federal Register is a once in time publication, but the CFR is, you know, reissued year after year and organized by subject matter. So that seems valuable to me, but I don't know is whether this would be unusual in the CFR because it's not a regulation. It's, we're not recommending that it be issued in that form as a notice and comment rule.
Right. Thank you, Nick.
I worked at the IRS, so I'm going to just mention from their perspective, they'll never do that. The procedures for getting a private letter ruling at the IRS are published every year in the Internal Revenue Bulletin, which you can access, maybe not so easily, but you can access through the website. Years ago, when I'm talking back in the 1970s, they did publish in both the Federal Register and the CFR, and it's still there. I don't know if the consultant managed to find that, but nobody looks there and nobody uses that. It's an outdated procedure there. But everybody looks at the at the Internal Revenue Bulletin. So, I mean, if I were advising the commissioner what to do, I would say, well, don't bother. I know what this recommendation says, but it's working perfectly well right now. And it's extra effort to publish it in the Federal Register. And the ruling process, if I remember correctly, the ruling process is a self-fund, by statute, is a self-funding program. And I'd say, you don't want to raise user fees just so you can afford to publish it in the Federal Register. I'd tell them to forget it.
I'd like to sort of bring in Shalini to get her reporting on what she heard from administrative agencies other than IRS, for which Lon has background experience with, on making written procedures publicly accessible. Did they have comments or thoughts about the obstacles and challenges to doing that, or the feasibility of making these procedures publicly available? I know that your report didn't mention making them available in the Federal Register or Code of Federal Regulation, but I wonder if they had any thoughts about the accessibility or making them available point.
Yeah, I think it was pretty common for agencies to post really detailed instructions about how to submit a request on their website. And so, I think that was how a lot of agencies were, dealing with this issue, just posting it on their own agency website and not in some other repository.
Okay. Thank you so much, Shalini.
Can I just ask the professor a quick question? I'm wondering if in her research, she saw the IRS rules in the regulations, in the CFR. And if anybody at the IRS even mentioned that they were, most people in the IRS don't even know they're there.
I mean, I think the revenue procedure was where everyone was directing us.
Sure. Right. Yeah. But I mean, if you look at 26 CFR 601.201, you'll see an outdated version of it. And I'd say most of the people in the IRS and most of the tax committee doesn't even know it exists. Okay. That's why I wondered why do we want to tell them that they have to publish it there? I understand the FOIA issue, but
so Lon, would you, in terms of thinking about revisions, would it be a shift from agency should or agency may, or it would be sort of the taming down of the language should, or do you disagree with even the idea of publishing in the Federal Register or the Code of Federal Regulations generally?
Well, I think, first of all, there's two things going on here, and I would say that they should publish. I mean, that's an advantage to the agency to make sure that the public knows what rules they need to follow.
Sure.
So should do it. That's fine. I think that's a great idea. But it might be published in, such as the Federal Register or
something
like that. I don't have the language worked out.
Got it. Okay. That helps me understand your point. Any additional comments, Lon, or?
No, that was the only one I had on that. Thank you.
Okay, great. So let's move forward to Kevin, and we'll keep that Lon's proposal and think about it after we hear more comments.
Yeah, thank you so much. I suspect others want to talk on the same point, as do I. I think that I just want to make one background comment and then maybe a recommendation, which is I was looking at the OMB's bulletin on good guidance practices, and that just required publication, I think, on the website, didn't require any specific source. And so I wonder about, to me, I can see a good reason to have it published in the Federal Register as a, you know, highly public and visible place for publishing. I don't know that we can command that these appear in the Code of Federal Regulations. I believe that the Office of the Federal Register polices quite narrowly what goes into the Code of Federal Regulations. So I guess my recommendation would be, I think I'm generally supportive without much familiarity of the IRS context. So acknowledging that, Lon, just to say the agency should publish these procedures, hopefully on their websites. Do we say that somewhere else? And in the Federal Register.
Okay.
Yeah, kind of another alternative recommendation, but leave off the CFR.
Okay. So agency should publish such procedures, or these procedures on there. And we have on the next sentence that they should make the procedures publicly available on their website. So we could move that up and also suggest that they make the procedures available or publish them on the Federal Register, but leave off the Code of Federal Register, Code of Federal Regulations. Is that right? Okay.
My suggestion.
Okay. Thanks, Kevin. Bill.
Well, first of all, to respond to Nina, she may have misunderstood that this is what we're dealing with here are regulations, not the guidance themselves that we're talking about. And as regulations, I it's not my impression that when you have procedural regulations that they're supposed to be published in the Federal Register and indeed codified in the Code of Federal Regulations. And if I'm right, that's what Freedom of Information Act, APA, require. I don't think we need to say it. I think what we should say is agencies should at least make the procedures publicly available on their website. Just leave off the first sentence and say at least to make clear that there's alternative ways of doing it as well, including what might be required by law.
Okay, so we have kind of two proposals. Bill's proposal to focus on agencies making the procedures at least make procedures publicly available on their websites. And then Kevin's proposal of, you know, publishing the procedures in the Federal Register and the websites. Matthew.
I agree with Bill Funk generally. I mean, these are procedural rules of the sort that I can't speak with the frequency with which these kind of procedural rules do appear in the federal, in the CFR, but certainly even outside the adjudication context, there are all sorts of procedural rules that appear in the Federal Register, including to give a type of procedural rule that ACUS highlighted, rules governing rulemaking procedures. So I don't think there's anything unusual about putting these in the Federal Register, in the Code of Federal Register. And you know, if they're of a certain level of formality, these procedures, they probably should be in the CFR.
Okay. And so Matthew, would that lead to an explicit recommendation about publishing the Federal Register and the Code of Federal Regulation, or?
I guess the question for the committee is, I'm actually doing research for ACUS on this very subject in terms of what procedural rules go in the Federal Register and what the CFR, excuse me, and what doesn't. I don't really have a conclusion yet, but I would raise, I think Bill's solution might be fine, but it does raise the question, why is it that, you know, in this recommendation, ACUS will not be mentioning the rules being codified in the CFR, but in any number of other recommendations, including most of ACUS's adjudication recommendations, ACUS recommends that the procedural rules be codified in the CFR. That's a very common provision that you find in ACUS recommendations, at least in the adjudication context. I can't speak to other contexts off the top of my head, like the recommendation on rules on rulemaking.
Got it.
Maybe Bill's solution works in this context well enough.
Okay. Thanks so much, Matt. Nina.
Very quickly, I completely agree with Matt, and given ACUS's other recommendations and apparently indications that not all agencies actually are publishing their procedures in the Federal Register and Code of Federal Regulations, I'm not sure why we wouldn't remind them at a minimum to comply with these legal obligations.
So what I'm hearing, there's three proposals that are put forth. The first one, we'll start with kind of this, from the least amount to the most. Bill would suggest that we just have a provision recommending that agencies make procedures publicly available on their websites. Kevin would have a would amend to say this should make them available in the Federal Register and their website. And then the third proposal is to keep as is with respect to the Federal Register, Code of Regulation, and the website. Not clear in terms of how to resolve this without necessarily going to a vote, which I prefer to not get to, but are there any sort of, I guess going back to Bill, is are Nina and Matt's ideas satisfying to you? Are you still, would you still prefer that it only suggests making it available on the website?
Well, I'm happy to leave it as it is. I was just trying to propose a solution to anyone who felt problems with including the first sentence there.
Okay.
Including Federal Register and Code of Federal Regulations. I'm happy to leave it in.
Okay. Thank you. Kevin.
And I, with the helpful reminders of ACES's past practices in, with regard to procedural rules, I kind of withdraw my suggestion.
Okay.
I mean, I think there is a discretionary judgment made, but if these, you know, and I'm not sure Matt can tell us how often procedural rules end up in the Code of Federal Regulations, but why not recommend it?
Right. Okay. And I forgot to acknowledge Lon's concern with respect to the IRS, the fact that, you know, they're not likely to do this, not likely to follow recommendations, question of whether other other agencies would be similarly positioned. But let's start with Matt and then we'll go to Lon.
Just, I mean, one alternative, and I'm not a member of the committee, and just picking up on Kevin's suggestion, if there is some degree of discretion associated with what procedural rules go in the CFR, you could have a clause, a parenthetical clause that says as appropriate. Publishing the CFR would be another option.
Okay. So yeah, this kind of goes along with, I'm sorry, I forgot your suggested addendum, Lon, with respect to making the change to the language such that it indicates that we recognize that some agencies, it might not be appropriate in all contexts to codify them in the Code of Federal Regulations at least. So we could put as appropriate as a parenthetical, or we could do agencies should publish such procedures on their websites and through other means such as. That's not very articulate language, but you know, that's one thought. Lon, please.
Yeah, that's what I would go with. Like I said, I had this discussion with the people when I was working there about the old regulation that was out there. And I said, you know, you need to update it. Or get rid of it. And they don't have time for that. It's not in the budget to do that. It's a big deal. Right. As you may have seen, I don't know if you looked, I'm sure that your consultant has looked at it. The initial procedures that are published every year, the very first, I think, seven revenue procedures, 300 pages in the Internal Revenue Bulletin, to reformat that and do that every year at the Federal Register, it's just not worth it. Nobody cares. Nobody's looking there. They're looking at the website. They're going to find the Internal Revenue Bulletin. If they're professionals, they're going to have commercial tax services. They're going to see the revenue procedure. Even the commercial tax services don't mention, really, don't focus on the regulation. And I just, it's really, for the IRS anyway, it's a waste of time to do it, waste of money. And like I said, it's a self-funding program. So they're not going to do it. Right. I don't know how, you know, if there's a legal requirement to do it anyway, they're probably going to say, well, live with the consequences of that. Mm-hmm. So I just, you know, again, it's one agency's view, and I understand it's not the only agency around, but it is a longstanding program, and it's a very large program. When I was there, I think there were 6,000 to 8,000 letter rulings published, issued a year. And that's not technical advice, not some of the other stuff. So, and probably even more. I mean, and some letter rulings are required by statute. You can't change an accounting method without getting permission of the commissioner, and that's done through a private letter ruling. So I just, again, I don't see them doing it. They're going to have the time and resources to do that twice, yeah. Publishing yeah. twice.
So, anyway. Yeah, so, I mean, I would, you know, support sort of the qualifying language as appropriate or such as whatever might fit in with respect to the committee of style in terms of how it might play out. But I want to make sure that there are no objections to for to that suggestion.
Like what's there would I think works. It's, you know, as appropriate or I think that works.
Okay. Bill.
I just wanted to point out that there wouldn't be a need to annually publish it in the federal regulations. Go to federal regulations or the Federal Register. You publish it in the Federal Register once and put it in the Code of Federal Regulations, it just carries over. It's not like you have to pay for it separately.
Yeah, but the procedures change every year. That's why the IRS republishes them every year as the first one.
And I think that's fine. I think it would be nice if in this first two sentences we make clear that this is the only way you should do it, right? That if we keep that the first sentence, as I say, I'm not unhappy with it because I just looked at the APA. It's pretty explicit. I think that they have to be published there. Whether people do or not is another question. Mm-hmm. But the second sentence that should also make, and I think should at least also make, because there may be things like your revenue bulletins that are even mm-hmm. better than the website.
Okay. So changing that sentence that starting with agency should also make, should Bill suggest an agent should at least also make the procedures. And of course, we could sort of make adjustments based on style and the committee on style. Other suggestions. And so let me see if there are any objections to the changes that have been made to recommendation 6. And Lon, is that an old hand up or is that a new hand?
No, that's an old one. Sorry. Okay,
great. No problem. Nina.
Sorry. As appropriate should go in front of codify, not in front of the whole sentence, because I think everybody pretty much agrees that this belongs in the Federal Register. The only uncertainty is whether it needs to be codified in the CFR.
Okay. So agencies publish such procedures in the Federal Registration and as appropriate, codify them in the Federal Register. Okay. Any objections to the now newly amended language? All right. So are there any sort of, yes, David?
Without trying to wordsmith now, I would suggest that once the decision is made as to what we're telling the agencies to do and where to do it, to cut down the number of times the phrase the procedures.
Yeah, I agree. I agree.
So it could, for example, get rid of the tail end of this, the procedures should describe.
Yeah.
So agencies should develop written procedures for requesting and issuing individualized guidance as described below.
Yeah.
But get rid of these repetitive references to procedures.
Could not agree with you more, David. So we'll make those adjustments.
Thanks.
So it's not the procedure should describe the procedures. It will be a little bit more articulate, I guess. Ray.
Hey, thanks. One thing, I don't know if this might help the concern with IRS, but one thing that strikes me is whether we should decouple the requirements for posting how one requests these as opposed to how the agency goes about processing them and issuing them. Like, I assume you could have a sort of standard method for requesting them. At least at EEOC, we have in the CFR rules about how you request them, but then, you know, how we go about making decisions about how, you know, when we're going to issue an individualized guidance, that's not something that we have up. So I don't know if that's worth a conversation or not. It just strikes me as something that may make it easier on agencies that may have internal procedures that are changing all the time about how they go about issuing them, as opposed to the whatever the public needs to do in order to make a request for an individualized guidance.
Right. And so the idea is that the making the request for an individualized guidance, that procedure wouldn't change all that frequently. Is that the idea, or am I getting it wrong?
Yeah, that's at least that's the way it works with us.
Yeah. Okay. So, you know, right, kind of getting into how this would change the recommendation as structured, would it separate out, I'm trying to think about A through C from the rest, or I don't know, I guess we're moving down, no matter which. So yes.
Yeah, the only thing I want to know is that, yeah, this current six is directed to the requesting an issuance of individualized guidance, whereas seven, which we haven't gotten to yet, focuses on agency internal procedures or processes for managing the kind of receipt and processing of them. So just wanted to note that.
I see. Okay.
I may not get to everything that Ray's saying, but just wanted to mention that.
Sure. Thanks, Ben.
So then would it make sense up in six, if you could scroll back up there, to just have this recommendation be about the written procedures for requesting individualized guidance and not the issuing, and then the issuing is a matter that's discussed in seven, or is that seen as separate?
So I'm trying to think in terms of, oh yeah, I got it. For written procedure for requesting individualized guidance. Yes, Bill.
It seems to me that F6F refers to the sort of internal, what's going to happen internally, right, as opposed to how people actually make requests. Right. And I don't know if you need to change the introductory language in six. And the only question I have is whether or not F is appropriate here. In other words, whether that information definitely should be made public. Because it seems to talk about how it's done inside the agency, as opposed to just the person who will issue it, right? That would seem to be the office that issues it, isn't very internal, and that might be published. But the procedure for responsible for preparing, reviewing everybody who's working on the thing, that may be going a little far.
Okay. In terms of not being necessary to be published,
exactly,
in any form, or are we talking about the Federal Register and Code of Federal Regulation?
I meant published at all.
At all, okay. So A through E, perhaps there's broad agreement that that should be published and made available in the ways we suggested in the preamble. And there's a question about F. And then I guess if we scroll down to see what's F, G through K. So if we see F through K in the same, so I guess I'll give you a chance to read. So the question is, do we need to recategorize F through K, or do they fit within the parameters really that are focused on the process of requesting guidance and the recommendation for public availability that we make for those requests? Should all of them be fit into that category, or should F through K be marked out, or some of F through K be marked out for a different suggestion with respect to making publicly available? Bill.
I think G through K are all appropriate to be made public. It's okay. Only F, I think, that relates to the internal procedures of the agency of how it's going to go about making these things. So I'm not a member of the committee, but I'd recommend just deleting F.
Okay. Does a member of the committee want to support that recommendation? Ray?
I'll support that recommendation.
Okay. So the recommendation is to delete F from the recommendation with respect to making public available through the different means described in the preamble of 6. Any objections to that change? Right. If there are no objections, I guess we'll kind of scroll down and look at G through K to make sure there's no other suggestions with respect to changes to those. There are changes to K that were made in response to discussion at our first meeting. Okay. There you go. Yes, Matt.
I'll reserve this for the committee on style. There's the little grammatical problem with E. I'll just make a change. I'll make a post committee suggestion. I'm sorry.
Okay. Thanks, Matt. Okay. There are no comments or suggestions with respect to G through K. We'll move forward to recommendation number 7. 7A through D.
Yeah, Bertral, I just wanted to flag, folks may want to read this comment. We had some discussion at the first committee meeting about kind of the substantive development of substantive policies regarding reliance versus the question about procedurally how agencies are going to convey that information to individuals. And so that's what this comment gets to, and that's what this edit is addressing.
That's right. Thank you, Ben. So why don't we take some time to read the comment and see if there are any suggested modifications necessary. Based
and on once that. Folks have had a chance to read this, I can move up to 3.
Yeah. Unless anyone needs more time, we'll kind of have Ben scroll up to 3.
And if folks remember this language was changed at the first committee meeting. It's, I think, before it said agencies should determine when it is appropriate to allow reliance, and we changed it to develop policy. So then that kind of got into a discussion about kind of, is this a procedural kind of related recommendation or more of a substantive one? I think it was more of a substantive one, and we just kind of made that change down below to make it clear that this is kind of about factors agencies should consider versus incorporating that into the procedural rules
right
down below.
Right. So I guess we'll kind of, so you had a chance to read 3, and we'll come back to K again and see. To make sure that it's clear that distinction between kind of the substantive and the procedural elements, that that distinction is clear in terms of the recommendation as structured. Yes, Nina.
I'm genuinely uncertain about what to do here. It does seem that if an agency actually has a policy, it would be good if they included it in what they published. To me, the question is, if they Yeah, I'll leave it at that.
Okay.
So if they have a...
Yeah, you know, the, I don't know, the Mead case, which involves Customs Service rulings, you know, the Customs Service actually did have, they did actually publish their position on whether there should be reliance, and there was extremely limited reliance. But they also had a systematic position. The only reason I hesitate here is because it could be that perhaps an agency decides it just has a very variable approach to reliance, perhaps depending on the issue, perhaps depending on the requester. Then I'm not sure it makes sense to say that. But if they actually have a policy on reliance, your important value is served by making that public, both to potential requesters who might not have an intimate knowledge of the agency otherwise, and to the public.
Right. So, Shalini, this might have been outside the scope of your research, but I was wondering if you came across any discussions about whether there were agencies that had general policies on reliance, or whether they treated reliance as an individualized, you know, case-by-case determination.
Well, for some agencies, the reliance question is dealt with in the statute that describes the procedures. And so I'm thinking of probably the Federal Election Commission and the Department of Labor's Wage and Hour Division opinion letters. So I think the extent to which the requester and others might be able to rely is actually addressed in the statute in those cases.
Got it. Okay. So there are general reliance policies statutorily required, statutorily determined. So that maybe points to in favor of Nina's point in terms of it might be helpful to have that general reliance policy publicly available. Nick.
Just following up on Nina's point, I mean, if the agency actually has a standing policy that it generally follows, I would think that it would be foible as working law. And if that's the case and there are sophisticated parties involved, you'd expect someone to FOIA the thing and that it would be passed around anyway, at least among people in the know. Now perhaps that counsels in favor of a recommendation to just disclose generally, but I'm happy to hear from others on that.
Yeah. So maybe when it making it requiring or suggesting publication would, you know, avoid that sophisticated party advantage with respect to this general reliance policy law.
Now, just again, it's from one agency's perspective. It's statutory for the Internal Revenue Service, but it's to the agency's advantage to put that in there. Even if it was in a statute, 6110K3 now, yeah. Every letter ruling has a reference to that, saying it, you know, can't be relied on as precedent by other taxpayers. And it's it because it's an agency's advantage to let everybody who's seeing that know that you who can and can't rely on it. So I would think that agencies would want to do it. And so I think this provision's fine.
Okay. So Nina, in terms of your comment suggestion, does it suggest a change to the language of K, or where does it lead you?
So on the fly, how about any policy developed, instead of whether and when it is appropriate, any policy developed as described in paragraph 3? Or any policy regarding reliance developed as described in paragraph 3? Mm-hmm. How does that sound?
Got it. Okay.
And then because we've got a cross-reference, how about, since you put me on the spot, any policy regarding reliance on individualized guidance developed as described in paragraph 3? That's what I propose.
Yeah, sorry, I didn't mean to.
No problem. I didn't have my pen out.
Okay. Individualized guidance developed as described in paragraph 3. Okay. And then we would delete the remaining language. Does that properly reflect your suggestion, Nina? Okay. Kevin.
Yeah, I like Nina's edit, and I'm just raising a question, which is whether it seems to make sense that in spelling out all these procedures, they should refer to in public, you know, these policies regarding reliance should be specified here. I wonder also in paragraph 3, there should be a reference to whether the policies developed regarding reliance should be published.
Okay.
I don't know. I don't want to bring us back, but we've had a kind of intense conversation about publication here, but should develop policies. We're saying they should develop policies in paragraph 3.
Right.
And I think it's important that they be referred to in whatever, I guess it's paragraph 6 that we're talking about. But I'm just throwing out to the committee whether we would just maybe for parallel also want to suggest some sort of publication, should develop and publish policies.
Okay.
And then that of course raises the question of where, and we've had an extensive conversation about that too, okay. But I flag those issues. Those could be matters of style, I don't know.
Okay. I don't know, maybe this is crazy to have a cross-reference to a cross-reference, but do we cross-reference paragraph or recommendation 6 here?
Just one, I think that it's nice to have the cross-reference because the paragraph 6 really is setting out all the policies, probably the primary place the someone who's looking for the guidance is going to, or looking for anybody, will go. And it's, I think it's nice to have a kind of cross-reference to the policies on reliance there, right, as a sort of.
Got it. Bill.
I'm confused now because I thought that's exactly what Nina's amendment to number 6 would do, would require the publishing of the policy adopted in 3. So I don't see why we, I mean, 3 is all about developing the policy, 6 is all about publication. So I'm now confused as to, we get 2 different publications, we're going to get a separate publication of policies and then a separate publication, we do the publish the procedures. I'm confused.
Kevin?
I guess maybe I was thinking it'd be nice to have a consolidated from the agency's perspective, but maybe that's right. Maybe Nina's taking care of that. Thank you, Nina. That the policies developed will now be required to be published under 6.
Okay. So
we can take it out of 3.
Yeah. I guess I was imagining that what 6 said might be a reference to the policies regarding reliance.
Got it. Okay, so we've left that now as is.
Is there still an interest in potentially referencing 6K, cross-referencing it, like a mutually reinforcing cross-reference?
I take that as a no, or Bill?
I don't think so. I think with referring back to 3 and 6 is all you need.
Yeah. Okay. So let's keep that as is, unless there's any objections. And we'll kind of move back down to 6K to make sure we're all set with, just want to, you know, make sure that there are no objections to Nina suggested edits to K. Okay, so let's work with 7, A through D. I think you all, we'll just give another moment to make sure to remind ourselves what we just read a few moments ago. Any comments on 7A through D? Kevin.
Sorry, maybe this one. Do we want to say use in part C to identify and use them, okay, here, or to identify and consider? use, I think, suggests a little bit, there's slightly different meanings. And I think that I would probably slightly prefer consider. I don't, it's not an important point, but.
Got it. Let me see. Yeah, I agree. I like the language consider over use and line two of C.
Sorry.
So the identify and consider. I'm sorry. Identify and consider. Is that the suggestion, Kevin?
Yes.
Okay. Any objections to that edit? Any other comments on 7, A through D? All right, we'll move forward to recommendation 8. And we'll start with Bill.
I have several questions about this particular one. One is the idea of soliciting public participation before guidance, and the other separately is the idea of soliciting public participation after issuing guidance. I believe that a lot of these things would be the timeliness is fairly important, and you don't want you want to get them as fast as possible. Some of them may be big picture items that you want to have that, but here, it just seems to me that this is too broad. Should consider soliciting public participation? I guess I could go along with that, but just the idea that in every case in which members of the public are likely to have information, the agency should solicit information before issuing guidance is, to my mind, too far. And I'd like to address that issue separately from the how you deal about the after issue, because that's raises different issues in my mind.
Okay. Can I bring in Shalini here again to see if she had any, you know, contact and engagement with agency officials on their process of soliciting public participation, and whether they had any comments about how it may have slowed the process or raised the concerns that Bill has identified with including that requirement here or including that recommendation here.
Yes. So I don't think we had a lot of instances where agencies were soliciting public participation. I think the whole idea with individualized guidance is you're providing an answer to a requester. And so the information solicited is largely from that party. And, you know, you don't see a lot of instances of agencies asking others to weigh in.
Okay. And so I guess there's two responses to that analysis or that reporting from Shalini. One is to include the language to consider, or the other is to maybe it goes too far to delete recommendation 8. Yes, Nick.
I think that hedging it, I think keeping it in and hedging it with consider would be fine. And I think that would be consistent with what was said in the AGIS recommendations in 2017 and 2019 about general policy statements and general interpretive rules AGIS did encourage agencies to consider public participation with a whole series of factors that had to be balanced.
Thanks, Nick. So we have, and then I'll take, I guess Bill's not a member of the committee, so I'll take Nick. Would you put yourself as a person proposing that change in language to the recommendation?
Sure.
Sure. Okay, thanks. Lon.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
I don't know how the IRS would do this without disclosing taxpayer information, which is illegal. Mm-hmm. So consider at the very least.
Okay.
But I don't know how you would get people in on an individual transaction without violating disclosure laws.
Right. So, I mean, this kind of reinforces softening the language here and perhaps consider as a right softening here.
I think that would work.
Okay. Thanks, Lauren. Bill.
I consider soliciting is fine with me in that sense. But of course, it's consistent. I mean, Nick talked about generalized guidance, and here we're talking about individualized guidance. Maybe starting eight with something along the lines of, in cases in which members of the public are likely to have information relative to the request or are likely to be significantly affected by the agency's action, agencies should consider public soliciting participation from such persons before issuing individualized guidance.
Okay.
So that sort of narrows the concept that it's usually not going to be the case, all right? But if indeed the situation occurs, then they should consider getting public comment.
Yeah, I support that proposed change in language as a amendment. And I guess I'll ask if there are any objections before getting to the point that you want to make about the after, Bill.
Yeah, and I'd like to add that put in significant, likely to be significantly affected. I mean, any effect is just, I think, too much.
Okay. Okay, so let's sit with that amended language for a moment and ask if there are any objections to it. Okay, having heard no objections, we'll include that language. And I guess when we return to Bill, you're comfortable with the language if we are talking about participation before, but I believe you had a concern about after language.
Yeah, I think maybe A should be 8A and B if we keep the after at all. The question is, after they've issued this individualized guidance and some member of the public who thinks that they might be affected by it, the agency should be asking them to comment on that. If I'm the agency, I've gone to the trouble of doing this, and if indeed the people would be significantly affected, I might have even considered getting their views on the thing. But after issuing every one of these things, somebody writes in and says, oh, I think something got to change. We have to deal with that is really burdensome. And if people want to write in and say, oh my God, you issued this individualized guidance, I'd like individualized guidance on this issue. Right. Well, okay. Then they're going to get the individualized guidance, not the comment on somebody else's individualized guidance. So I just delete the after altogether.
Yeah, I see that point. So it could be that, whatever after commentary with respect to afterwards or after the fact commentary with respect to individual guidance could be, reconstrued as a request for a new individualized guidance for which the before language would address the opportunities for participation for anyone else other than the requester who is making the new request for the individual guidance. Other thoughts on the after language and objections to removing the after language? Okay. So one last opportunity to read and offer suggestions or objections to the modified recommendation 8. Okay, having heard no objections, let's move forward to recommendation number 9. And this is in a new category about the public availability of individual guidance. Yes, Bill.
I'm sorry to keep bringing things up. I thought that a lot of this was repetitive. That is, it says maintain a page in the website, provides easy access to the procedures described in paragraph, it should say 6 now, not 5. But in paragraph 6, we've already said they're supposed to have this on their website. So I don't know why we sort of repeat exactly the same thing here. Especially with the title, Publicly Availability of Individual Guidance. And then it says all individual guidance are, they make publicly available. I agree that should stay in. And then information about electronically submitting requests for individual guidance. Well, again, we've already provided that that's going to be on the webpage. So I'm just not sure why of these 3 things that are identified here, only one of which is mentioned in the title, why we keep number 1, number 3, as it were.
Okay. Jeremy.
Yeah, at least the idea in drafting is not to say that they should be available on the website, but that you should have basically a portal, a single web page where all of this is easily available. I mean, there might be a better way to explain it, but the idea is that you don't want this stuff scattered across your website, consistent with previous ACUS recommendations. All this material should be made available in a central location and in a user-friendly manner.
I guess Bill, is that responsive to your concern? Would you still?
Well, I don't know what a page of the website means. All right, I mean you're going to have all the individual guidance that's publicly available. All right, obviously won't be on the same page. I mean there'll be a link on a page to that stuff. Right, but all the guidance itself won't be on the page, and I mean it seems to me that. Yeah, I agree. It all ought to be in a organized format, procedures of how do you do stuff, the guidance that's given. But I to say it, a page, I don't know. Is that clear to everybody else? It's certainly not clear to me.
It's phrased as a page that provides easy access to the procedures, the guidance documents, and information about electronic submissions. The idea is it's at least a landing page that takes you to all relevant information. Related to this recommendation.
Hey, Jeremy and everybody, is there another place in this recommendation, all these recommendations, that specifically calls out making public all the individual guidance documents? Or is this the only place where that's done?
I believe that this is the only place where that's done. One suggested amendment is that you could perhaps make this more concise and less repetitive, is that agencies should make available individual guidance and procedures described in paragraph 6 on their website. The challenge here, Bill, I think is like, well, we want to sort of really encourage agencies to make available the individual guidance. And I think that this is the main thing that this
agreed. Is doing, absolutely.
Right. And maybe the cross-reference to 6 is just to make clear that ideally these the guidance and the procedures should be made available in proximity to each other on the website so that people can access both rather easily. So I think that's the idea, is kind of accessibility argument. But I agree in terms of, you know, we don't want to state things twice because it might raise some confusion as to whether they're supposed to do something different here when we're just reinforcing what we want them to do with respect to procedures, at least above.
Jeremy, do you think it's really a problem that you think that agencies will spread this stuff all around to make it not easy access? I mean,
It was enough of a problem that a few years ago we issued a recommendation on public availability of agency guidance that basically says agencies should maintain a web page on their websites that provides access to this information. So, I mean, I guess that's one response. We thought it was enough of a problem a few years ago, at least with generalized guidance documents.
Somehow it seems to me we ought to split off the idea, I mean, the super important idea that the individualized guidance that they'll make public should be easily available on their website, and maybe a separate idea that everything to do with individualized guidance ought to be organized in a fashion to be easily accessible to the public. And I'd leave it to the committee of style to say those sort of two different ideas, it just seems to me they're sort of different ideas.
I mean, one option is just to cross-reference the earlier recommendation, but I do think it'd be sort of strange to have a general recommendation on guidance that says you should have a web page like this, but have a different practice for certain kinds of guidance documents.
Right. Ron.
Maybe the problem is that the sentence we're focusing on, I guess it's 9, is intended to emphasize the point about a centrality or a single portal.
Right.
But it's placed before we've told them what individual things should be publicly available. And so it's a little bit illogical, and it might be better to have that come up after you've told them all the individual things that should be disclosed. And then you have a sentence that says, and the things referred to in paragraphs A, B, and C should all be in a single location.
I see. Yeah, it's a good suggestion. So this 9 would just be limited to a recommendation that agencies make individual guidances publicly available. Would it have reference to a website here, Ron, or would that reference that website be reserved to a separate paragraph?
Well, I understood Jeremy to be saying it's important to emphasize that it should all be in one place. And so I was trying to keep that idea, but I was trying to say it's a little premature at this spot. And so after you've said all the individual things that should be available, then you put in a sentence that highlights the centrality point.
Okay.
I agree completely.
Okay. Okay, so that would mean that 8 is, I don't know if there's anything we keep in 8 right here. Much of this perhaps will be moved down to a recommendation that follows 8. Unless I'm missing something in terms of something we want to keep, or 9, excuse me, something we want to keep at 9.
Well, I would think you'd say in 9, just what the title for the public availability of individual guidance say, agencies that provide individuals guidance should maintain a page on their websites that provides easy access to all individualized guidance documents that they make publicly available, period. And then have either a 10 or make it a B to 9A, that agencies should maintain a page in their websites that provides easy access to, and then whatever, all the different thing, the procedures, policies, and guidance.
So 11 also, or I guess what was 10 and now is 11 with this addition, also describes making other information publicly available as well. So should that go before the paragraph 10?
Well, I think that's a whole different issue, which is It,
in nine, it says you make available those that you've decided to make publicly available, then you should put it on your website.
Right.
And then 11 says you should make publicly available any individualized guidance that affects other people.
Right.
In other words, we don't have the what you've decided to make public. This is all of a sudden, this stuff should be made public, period.
Got it.
And to say it may be of interest to, I mean, that's all.
Right. So I guess the question for the committee is whether we should just be open and explicit with our recommendation that they should make all individual guidance available.
I mean, yeah, I think that's the question that 11 raises, because to say it may be of interest,
yeah,
you know, that's their world.
Yeah, that doesn't qualify really much. So let's kind of consider 9 and 11 in this modified document together and get committee's opinions on what should be made available in terms of individual guidance. Nick.
I would just like to hear from Shalini on this.
Yeah. Yeah. So thank you, Nick. It's great suggestion, Shalini, in terms of your experience engaging with agency officials and what they've made available.
Yes, I think we have a lot of examples of agencies that do have a website where letters are available. I don't know if it's every single letter, but I think they are trying to make those public. So a couple of examples, I think OSHA standards of interpretation, to the extent those are properly thought of as individualized guidance, you know, those are available. I know other parts of the Department of Labor, like Wage and Hour Division, and I think even DOJ's advisory opinions on the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. So there are lots and lots of examples. And then I think also the SEC and the CFTC, where those letters are provided kind of at the discretion of the agency. There isn't really I don't think those are mentioned in statutes. You know, they're sort of doing those out of their discretion. Those also are, I think, typically collected, or at least you can access them from one page. And there are different types of letters. And so on this sort of single page, you'll see, you know, those different letters defined, relevant authority, and then access to the letters.
Yeah,
I don't know if that's responsive to the question, but.
I guess I had a follow-up in terms of, did you have a sense from the agencies about whether there are particular costs and burdens associated with making publicly available individual guidance, or thoughts, you know, on the question of why you don't know if everyone was made available? Would it be, you know, too burdensome on an agency to make everyone available? Or did you give thoughts on that?
I didn't really hear anything about that. I mean, I didn't ask about, you know, the burdens of publicizing these letters. I think if it's actually, you know, the examples that I gave, I think those agencies are sort of accustomed to make, as a matter of course, kind of making those materials public.
So, got it.
Yeah.
Thanks, Shalini. Bill.
Shalini, are there any individualized guidance documents that an agency doesn't make publicly available?
So it's possible that if there's an email exchange, it's possible that those aren't then being posted somewhere. And those might properly be thought of as individualized guidance. So that's an example that comes to mind.
So that's my point, is that 11 would say they should be made public available.
Mm-hmm.
And that's I mean, I am in agreement that generally agencies should make them publicly available. But in 9, we recognize that agencies have a choice about what to make public and what not to make public. And I don't know if we have in this recommendation identified the thoughts that an agency should go through in deciding whether to make something public.
Yeah.
I mean, that might be a worthwhile addition if it's not already there, that I missed somewhere. To say, agencies should consider these factors in deciding whether to make things public. And then once you've decided to make it public, then that's how we make it available, which is what we're talking about here. But the first question is, should they be made public available? And we could say they all should be, but that would be changing individual practice the way it is now. And we should say, decide for yourselves and we won't give you any guidance. Or we could say, come up with guidance as to what should be considered in making things public.
Yeah, it's my sense from your report, Shalini, that we really didn't gather enough information. It's not really the focal point of the report, but we didn't really gather enough information to necessarily make the recommendation on what to make publicly available. Is that your sense in terms of the information that you gathered? There wasn't much response to that question, or that question didn't really come up in the discussion. Is that an accurate assessment?
I think so. I mean, I think our questions were mostly geared to sort of just understanding the current practices and not so much. And a lot of the agencies do have these websites, so there wasn't a lot of discussion about what wouldn't be available. Yeah, or why.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, Shalini.
I did want to just add there was one instance where an agency where national security issues come up kind of made the point that often recommendations are made to disclose, but that it's hard for them to comply. I think the recommendation I think there is some discussion of like sensitive security information, obviously is not going to be publicized. And so things like that, I think agencies do think about reasons not to disclose, and it's things like that. And a lot of them, though, I would think are just covered by FOIA. So I don't know.
Right. Okay. So yes, Lon, and then we'll go to Nick.
I think that having a strong recommendation that they disclose is a good thing. The IRS had a long history on this. Back in the 50s, 60s, even early 70s, the IRS was starting to issue thousands of these a year. And many of them, the requests came in from large accounting firms, large law firms with significant tax practices. And IRS was accused of having a sort of a private law that only certain people, and particularly in Washington, knew about it. And there's, disclosure of tens of thousands of these things is difficult. Anyway, I think it was 1976, Section 6110 was added to the Internal Revenue Code requiring it. And it has since been expanded. So if an agency doesn't disclose it, people complain, they're liable to be under attack, and they're going to end up with legislation that requires them to do it. And as I look at 6110, it's any written determination, and that includes some of the background information. It's required to be affirmatively disclosed, not waiting for somebody to make a FOIA request. And written determination includes a ruling, a determination letter, technical advice memorandum, which is advice from the national office to a revenue agent to help them during an examination, and any chief counsel advice. And that is very broad. That's any advice that the Office of Chief Counsel provides to anyone outside of the Office of Chief Counsel. Okay. And it's required to do it. Is it burdensome and costly? Yes. But Congress said you can't keep this stuff private. You can't have a private law that certain people have access to. So based on that history, I recommend people that get ahead of that and start disclosing it on their own. Right. It's also, I found, a benefit to the agency because, yes, members of the public look at these things, and you occasionally get phone calls saying, there's lots of these things going on, and that encourages people at the IRS to either publish regulation addressing it so that people can rely on it more broadly, or even sub-regulatory guidance like a revenue ruling. It does help your program. It helps you get information from the public. It is costly. There's no question about it. But, once you have a statutory requirement, then you're going to have to deal with it anyway. So I'd get ahead of it. I think a strong recommendation to do it is a good idea.
I guess, yeah, aside from the cost, I'm just wondering if we're failing to account for any justifications for non-disclosure. National security was the one raised by Shalini. Are there other considerations that we might not be accounting for here? And if we are, should we include some qualifier language with respect to making publicly available? I guess, yeah, thank you for highlighting that in 13. Maybe that's enough of a qualifier with respect to allowing for the redaction of certain information from disclosure. Maybe that's enough. Let me turn to Nick.
I think consistent with what Lon just said. So, in the AGIS recommendations about general policy statements and general interpretive rules in 2017 and 2019, the big concern there was how you balance two things. On the one hand, the flexibility that policy statements and arguably interpretive rules are supposed to have as a matter of law, on the one hand, and then on the other hand, the legitimate demands for consistency that you would get from regulated parties, especially if, say, they're economic competitors with each other. What AGIS ended up doing in those recommendations is saying that, you know, these are, you know, two legitimate concerns that have to be balanced. And if you have enough resources, the way to balance them is that the agency should keep an open mind to do individualized departures from the general guidance. And you might say that, you know, each of those individualized departures, you know, it is an instance of the individualized guidance that we're now focusing on. But AGIS also recognized that it could be burdensome to the agency to disclose and disseminate all of the individual guidance, although we also said that, you know, there was a lot of value in doing so, because, you know, if you have an individualized departure, that serves the value of flexibility. But then if you disseminate the rationale for the individualized departure to everybody else so that everybody else, you know, can argue it if it fits their circumstances too, then you're serving the value of consistency. So having a recommendation in here, recognizing the value of disclosure and publicity and dissemination of these individualized determinations somehow is important. But there is, I mean, as Lon said, it can be, you know, economically burdensome to do the disclosures. And so, there were some competing considerations laid out in the previous recommendations on general policy statements and general interpretive rules that the agency could, you know, kind of balance with each other when it was facing limited resources. So, I mean, but I agree that something along these lines really ought to be in here. But I mean, maybe there are ways of qualifying it somewhat.
So a couple questions that are raised with respect to 11 is, first, do we keep the language as is? Do we modify the language? Do we delete the language in 11? And then the second point is, if we do keep 11 in some form, do we move it above current or the new recommendation 10? Bill.
Well, I would say we keep 11, right? Except maybe introduce it by saying something like, absent substantial countervailing reasons, agency should make public available any individualized guidance. Absent any
substantial countervailing reasons.
Any substantial countervailing considerations, right?
Considerations.
Okay. So making it clear that the general rule should be that you make them publicly available. Then, if that's acceptable, right? Then back to what used to, what's 9 now, right? I would say that comes out completely. 10 comes out completely under this series of recommendations. And then when we get after the next section, we have something about, a new section that talks about how to make all of the, what we talked about, the procedures, the policies, the individual guidance, to make that accessible on an easy basis, all right? The idea that Jeremy is trying to get across, but as a separate, because this is all about individual guidance. 11, 12, 13 are all specific as the individual guidance, and keep that together.
Okay, I see. So we would have, so just kind of following on the recommendations of Bill, it would be to delete 9 and 10, to maintain 11 with that qualifying language, to add a different part, different bolded section that would be titled after this one, I don't know, centralized accessibility. I don't know, I'm not good at doing things on the fly like Nina is, but it would be a different section that would recommend centralizing this information and making it accessible, or making this information essentially accessible, or accessible together on a website. Okay, so we'll hold that in the comment section or in the comment box and come back to it after we work through the rest of these recommendations in public availability and digital guidance. But before moving forward, are there any objections to what Bill has suggested with respect to eliminate previous 9 and 10 and starting with what was 11 and now is 9 with the qualifying language? Okay. Having heard no objections, let's move forward to recommendation 10. We'll try to get through 10 through 12 and take a break. But we'll see if this takes too long. We'll take a break before we get through 12. Lon.
I just want to make a quick comment. Somebody had mentioned something about email guidance.
Yes.
I can tell you for the IRS, email guidance is guidance.
Yeah.
It must be disclosed. It's required under 6110.
Right.
To cut back on burden, somehow they have managed, somebody's written a program to automate that. It somehow recognizes what's being sent out and asks the question, is this, Eden's guidance to such and such a group or a person? And if you click on it, it automatically gets sent up to the disclosure unit and they put it in their thing, a group of things that get disclosed once a week. So it can be done and can be made less burdensome, but it is guidance, at least for the IRS.
Yeah. Well, in the world of generative AI, maybe this will all be costless in the future, in the near future, maybe. All right. So thanks for that comment, Lon. So let's turn to 10, A through C. So I guess I have an initial comment in terms of whether the reliance point in B is captured in 6K or not, or maybe this is a different sort of recommendation with respect to reliance that I'm not capturing. But any thoughts or suggestions with respect to 10, A through C? Yes, Ray.
So in A, identifying the requester, I know it says as appropriate above, but I think in many circumstances, identifying the requester is going to be a problem either for us under the Privacy Act and Title VII. I'm sure other organizations have their own requirements. I would just say identifying the date, subject matter of the guidance.
Okay.
Doesn't 11 take care of that, Ray?
Oh, let me look. I didn't look at that. Yeah, it does. That's fine. Never mind.
Yes.
Okay. Other comments on 10?
And then I guess in B, I just have a question, which is, when it's saying identify the legal authority, is it contemplating that that's going to be some within the text of the individualized guidance itself, or is that a reference to having that somewhere else? I'm not entirely clear. Nope.
Interesting. So yeah, so it could be interpreted as identifying the legal authority on the website rather than within the individual guidance. Laura. Laura Barheit. I'm sorry if I'm mispronouncing your last name.
Hi, sorry. It took me a second to get unmuted.
No worries.
So what is the value of identifying the requester? I can just imagine people are writing in with no expectation that they're going to be sort of put out there as having asked the question. And I'm just wondering, what is the value of providing the requester?
So in terms of the individual guidance documents that were made available on websites, Shalini, was it typical practice to identify the requester? Did you know? And if so, were there any sort of arguments for why that's necessary?
Yeah, so I think there are instances where the requester is identified, where it's not sensitive information or trade secret information or anything like that. And my sense, I don't think we talked about this explicitly with interviewees, but my sense was that there are areas where third parties can invoke, you know, an advisory opinion or opinion letter that was issued to someone else, to a requester, and use that to kind of defend their own conduct or justify their own conduct. And being able to, I think it might help in reasoning by analogy and sort of, you know, this is a nonprofit that's about the same size as ours, and this is what we wanted to do. And so I suspect that it helps with using it. Mm-hmm. I don't think in the interviews we ever came across the idea that it was somehow necessary for it to be useful.
So Laura, kind of coming back to you with respect to that value attributed to the requester information, do you have any further thoughts?
Yeah, I'm just concerned that I can imagine a lot of instances where people are writing in, they're asking questions, and they have no expectation of that becoming public. And it also probably doesn't rise to the level of 11, where it's sensitive or legally protected from disclosure. And it just seems to me like the kind of thing where I just personally think that we should be careful of where it's a group or an organization, that's one thing, but where it's an individual person writing in to provide the requester information just seems unwarranted.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure that it's going to run to the level of 11.
Yeah. So it seemed like the reasoning by analogy, or, you know, reliance by analogy would be most relevant when we're talking about someone other than individuals, I would think, Shalini. I don't know, maybe I'm sort of my limits in my imagination with respect to how, you know, there could be, you know, a thought that an individual is like me, and so therefore I should be able to rely on in the same way. Not sure. Ron.
Recognizing that the most serious cases are addressed in 11, maybe the answer to the less serious ones that Laura is talking about would be to suggest that the portal that people use to submit requests should advise people that they will be identified, or they will be identified unless they, some other condition is satisfied. So tell them in advance, as opposed to the agency making some judgments after the fact.
Yeah, with that advising people that they will be identified with the, you know, website or whatever communication include an opportunity to opt out from being identified? I guess my concern with respect to, you know, the identification of requesters is that, you know, is there any sort of deterrent effect out of a concern with respect to the requester being identified, that they don't want to be identified, so that maybe they don't seek out the individual guidance in the way that they normally would? Laura, is that old hand or new hand, Laura?
Old hand, still okay. Trying to get it forward. There it is.
Got it, thanks. Okay, Bill.
I think with Ron's suggested addition to the procedures, earlier recommendation there, that the as appropriate would handle it. So if somebody said, I really don't want to be identified, then the agency could take account of that as appropriate, mm-hmm. without regard to even skipping to number 11, which would sort of demand it to be kept private. So I thought Ron's suggestion was it'd be a good addition to the procedures, and then that as appropriate in 10 would take account of the individual's concern.
Okay. So when making individual guidance documents available on the websites, agencies, and so where would that language advise people that they will be identified fit?
In an earlier section dealing with the procedures for making the request.
Got it. Okay. So we'll allow the committee or committee on style, Ben, Jeremy, and I to add that language to the procedures and then come back to that at our next meeting. Does that sound good?
Yep, sure. Yeah. So the consider adding that information to the earlier recommendations in terms of request, the procedure right. on requesting, and then come back to it at the next meeting.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
Got it.
Ron.
I don't think you want to decide right now, but I think when we do come back to that, the question will be not only notifying, here's what happens, but also the question of whether to give an option at that point.
Right. So maybe just kind of bracket the question of whether to provide an option.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other comments on recommendation 10? Okay. So let's move forward to recommendation 11. Yes, Ron.
Okay, two things. First, when I looked at lines 147, 148, referring to unwarranted invasion of personal privacy, I was immediately reminded of the great FOIA case, FCC versus AT&T, a dozen years ago, which held that AT&T could not take advantage of an exemption for unwarranted invasions of personal privacy because AT&T is a corporation and therefore could not avail itself of an exemption under a phrase that connotes something individualized.
Mm-hmm.
That opinion was most memorable for the closing line in which Chief Justice Roberts says, well, we're ruling for the government. We trust AT&T will not take it personally. In this context, I think, I don't know whether the intention is to limit this provision to privacy interests of individuals. Maybe it is, in which case it's fine as it stands, but if you want to be cognizant of the possible argument by a corporation about proprietary information, trade secrets, and the like, which I suspect is so, then I think you'd want to change personal privacy to privacy interests. Okay. So that it's it covers both.
Got it. I think that your intuition is right that we would want to extend the privacy interests beyond the individual. So I support that change of unwarranted invasion of privacy interests. Would that be the way you would phrase it, Ron?
That's what I would do.
Okay. Bill.
A question for Ron, which is why doesn't the earlier statement redact any information otherwise protected from disclosure? Why wouldn't that take care of it? I mean, that takes care of your 1905 information. And then the redact, I mean, this unwarranted invasion of personal privacy is, I think that's right out of the Freedom of Information Act and is intended to be limited to individuals. Whereas the corporate interests are really in the earlier language, sensitive or otherwise protected from disclosure.
So I guess the question is, is this limited only to legally protected information or agency is the information that they may not disclose, as opposed to deciding, you know, it just isn't unwarranted in our opinion. It doesn't say that it's limited to protected as a matter of law. Maybe that is what you want to say, but it doesn't say that now, I think.
Well, it says is sensitive or otherwise protected from disclosure. I mean,
right. And then it says redact details to the extent required, et cetera. So that is not keyed to the same.
Right. So the second redaction is not key to any sort of legal.
Okay, I don't feel particularly strongly about it. Just seemed to me it was already protected.
Yeah, no, I don't think it's redundant. I think it may be that what Bill had in mind is where the committee should come out. The other point I wanted to raise, which is connected to this, is that the paragraph seems to assume that there are no cases in which, because of sensitivity into privacy interests and the like, you wouldn't disclose the guidance at all. And maybe that is what the committee does intend. Maybe it's fully subsumed within the earlier language that says absent countervailing considerations. Mm-hmm. But if the committee wants to encourage the committee to the agency to think to itself, well, maybe there are some that shouldn't be disclosed at all because it would be, it would unduly intrude on privacy interests, then maybe you want to say it as opposed to letting it all be subsumed within line 134. Again, I don't really have an opinion. I just think that is something for the committee to ponder.
Right. Bill.
And of course, that was the purpose from my suggestion in 9 to deal, as Ron says, with the idea of the whole document, leaving to 11 the idea of parts of the document. So I thought it took care of it, but again, it's up to the committee.
Mm-hmm. Any thoughts in terms of whether there should be an explicit provision regarding non-disclosure of entire documents that would be necessary in addition to the language absent substantial countervailing considerations as a qualifier under recommendation 9? And then the second question is the second aspect of the redaction, redacting identifying details to the extent required to prevent unwarranted invasion of privacy interests. Is there any sort of suggestions that people might have with respect to adding or making clear the protection of identifying details that might be legally protected? I don't know if I'm capturing this right, Ron, in terms of the second part of the redaction. I understand your point with respect to the privacy interests, including individuals and non-individuals as well. But would there be, in terms of the point you were making earlier, the redaction of information that would be also to the extent required or to the extent that is subject to legal protections, or am I just missing something here?
Well, now that I read a little more closely, I suppose the word protected in line 46 implies legally protected because it doesn't really make sense otherwise.
Okay.
You could add legally to be even clearer about it, but I suppose, you know, that implication is there. Okay. I did not think the implication was there with regard to Alliance 147 and 148. But it's really a policy question for the committee.
Yeah.
You can do it either way.
Right. Any thoughts from committee members or others about paragraph 11 in particular? I am reading the room. I feel we are running out of steam. So why don't we take a break rather than get through 12, and we'll come back with any sort of additional thoughts on 10. Why don't we sort of take a 10-minute break and come back at the at 57, and then we'll reconvene. Okay, we'll resume. Oh, thank you, Ben. So we'll resume in about 30 seconds. So give you guys a chance to come back together. Okay, so we are working with recommendation number 11. We have one suggested edit and wanted to see if there are any other edits that or suggestions that people might have with respect to recommendation 11. Let's see. Sorry, my screen's messed up. Okay. Okay. There are no additional suggestions with respect to 11. Why don't we move to recommendation 12? Any suggestions, feedback on this recommendation? Okay, so here I would perhaps suggest that we add that new subsection that would refer to I don't know what to label it, centralized accessibility. It would be, a bolded subject subsection here that we will kind of wordsmith and work with. I think we have a good sense of what people want to put here, which is the point of recommending to the agency that they make available in, a centralized location website. Agency individual guidance, agency procedures, that these material all be sort of put together and on a website. Individual guidance, agency procedures, or guidance procedures, information with respect to requesters, the things that we have above. So we will add that for our next meeting and ask for your thoughts on the amended language or the additional added language here. Okay, so now let's move to recommendation 13. And I think that there was a comment by Jeff here.
Sorry, Patrol. Yeah, so the comment actually pertains to a separate issue. It's just he was talking about putting it at the end. So I think we can consider it after we discuss 13.
Okay, great. Thank you.
So any comments or suggestions with respect to recommendation 13? All right, and so I guess now we could sort of engage Jeff's thoughts about the use of ombudsman or ombudspersons, forget what the name of it is now. And there was a point in Shalini's report that referred to the use of ombudspersons. I'm just trying to pull up the language right now. I have it. Where is it now? Too many documents being open.
If it's helpful, Bertrall, I have it up and I can read it.
Okay, great. Thank you.
It's the last paragraph of the report that's available on our website. It says, finally, existing agency ombudspersons might help agencies develop protocols for advising the regulated community and the public more generally. Agency ombudspersons interact deeply with the regulated community to address grievances, and the resulting insights and relationships could benefit agencies' efforts to provide high-quality advice and customer service.
Right. And so the idea from Jeff is to kind of include a recommendation along the lines of, you know, encouraging or recommending to agencies that they, you know, use or employ ombudsmen, I can't say that, according to, you know, those practices that Shalini has identified in her recommendation. And we could sort of add a recommendation with respect to ombudspersons to this report that we can review at our next meeting. But I wanted to see if there are any, you know, broader thoughts about whether to make recommendations with respect to ombudspersons in the report at all, or in the recommendations, or add a recommendation with respect to ombudspersons into the here or not. David.
I was the staff person at the time in charge of the 2015 or 16 recommendation on use of ombuds. And after the meeting last time, I submitted a comment suggesting that the report, if it was going to talk about ombudsmen, refer not to the 1990 recommendation, but to the updated one. So I hope that Shalini got that message. They can make that amendment. But the other reason I want to speak up is that after much debate with the later recommendation, ACUS pretty much went along with the idea that it's okay to call them ombuds. And that's how we referred to them in that recommendation. So I suggest if you decide to add that point here, that you might as well follow that linguistic choice.
Great. Thanks, David. So we'll make reference to the person as agency ombuds, and then we will propose a recommendation that incorporates these existing uses of ombuds in agencies and making a recommendation along those lines. Any other thoughts about ombuds, or any sort of concerns or objections with respect to making a recommendation with respect to ombuds? We will have a chance to review it in our third meeting, but before we even write it, we want to make sure that there's no objections to a recommendation along those lines. Yes, Bill.
No objection. I just wonder whether it should be up nearer the front than at the end, because we're talking about, it would seem to me, you'd use the ombuds to help in developing the procedures. And so I was just looking at where it might go, and it seemed to me that it might go as another subpart of one, individualized guidance generally, sort of at the end of after five on individualized guidance generally. Just seems to me that it's when you're adopting the procedures and policies that you'd want to talk to the uploads, not sort of at the end.
Okay. Thanks for that, Bill. So we'll look to moving it to after five in the first section. Other thoughts or suggestions? Okay. So why don't we done with the recommendations, so we'll move all the way up to the preamble. And we'll take it paragraph by paragraph, starting with paragraph one, which includes lines 1 through 8.
And Bertrand, I just wanted to jump in. I think it might make sense.
May I interrupt for a moment? Before we leave the recommendations, I have a very small suggestion for something that I don't think anybody pointed out before. This is in, if I've got the right numbering, I think it's 6E. Okay. It's the one that starts any fees.
Right.
Yes. Seems to me the way this reads now, it kind of implies that there should be waivers, exemptions, or reduced rates. And it seems to me it would be better to say including any provisions for waivers, exemptions, or reduced rates.
Okay. So any provisions of waivers?
Including any provisions for, yeah.
Or waivers, okay. Exemptions.
Thank you.
Rates for, okay, thank you, David. Any objections to that change on 6E? And before we move to preamble, I think, Ben, you were going to tell me about the title.
Oh, yeah, I was just going to say it's up to the committee whether it wants to reserve that point until after the review of the preamble. We just wanted to make sure we didn't forget.
Sure, sure. So, Ron, before I guess we even go to the title.
Yeah, I wanted to speak to the title of the recommendation, if that is now in
order. Okay, let's talk about the title.
Yes, so this whole point about guidance that was not requested was mine originally. It's now reflected in the footnote. I trust that when Bertrand presents this to the assembly, he will say, thanks to an insightful comment by Ron Levin.
Always.
Yeah, of course. But I think the footnote is correct, but I think it would be better to revert to the original title and not make the changes indicated in the comment bubble. Because the tradition is to keep titles concise. And I think the way it would be understood generally would be that they're talking about guidance that the public requests. That's what the phrase connotes. Mm-hmm. And only the most assiduous hair splitters would think about the other option. And we've taken care of that now in the footnote.
Yeah.
But really, if that qualifier isn't important enough to be in the text of the preamble, and I think it isn't, then it also isn't important enough to be in the title.
Okay. Other thoughts on title? Okay, we'll take Ron's suggestions then. Here's a pick to the title. Keeping it concise and simple. I like that. All right, so if there are no further comments on the title, why don't we move to paragraph one of the preamble?
A quick comment on the title.
Okay.
It would be almost as concise to say individualized requested guidance.
Thoughts on
or the requested individualized guidance,
but not quite.
So there's been a suggestion and a proposal with respect to changing the title to either. Which one do you prefer, David? Individualized requested guidance or requested individualized guidance?
I have no preference between those, but okay. I think it's worth identifying it in the title.
Okay.
Yes, Kevin.
I was going to speak to paragraph one, but I kind of prefer the simple. I think, as Ron suggested on the title, since I'm here, of individualized guidance, I think complies enough in the general scheme that's requested that I don't know that we need that in the title, but that's not a small, big matter.
Yeah.
So I'll leave my hand up for paragraph one.
Sure. I prefer the simplicity with respect to individualized guidance. I think it may require that we, and when we refer to individualized guidance in the rest of the document, I wonder if we have to add that language requested. So it might require a bigger change than just to the title, but that's just my expression of preference. Bill?
Not a member of the committee, but I liked Ron's suggestion, and I think individualized requested guidance sounds a little weird.
Okay. And Lon?
I'm getting a little confused. Are we at the point where we're looking at individualized guidance and keeping the footnote?
Yes.
Okay. Because the IRS has individualized guidance that's not requested by the public.
Right.
It's requested by a revenue agent.
Right.
So I think it's fine if we keep the two-word title in the footnote.
Okay. David, do you hold to your objection? Would you still prefer further discussion on the title and the question of
repeat? No, it sounds like I'm outvoted.
Okay. So we'll go with individualized guidance. And then we'll come back to Kevin on the first paragraph.
Yeah, thanks so much. I had a suggestion that the first paragraph refer to OMB's prior policies that have governed management and publication of guidance. And I was looking back at the 2019 recommendation, which Jeremy helpfully put in the chat. And it says, I'll just quote here in the 2019 recommendation, this is right above footnote 11 for ACA staff. Although many agencies do post guidance documents online, in recent years, concerns have emerged about how well organized, up-to-date, and easily accessible these documents are to the public. At various times, the Office of Management and Budget, parentheses OMB, has instructed agencies on their management of guidance documents. And I can copy that and put that in the chat. So I guess I just feel like, consistent with that prior recommendation, and I also think it's useful to sort of alert that there's been OMB policy, which is generally in this space about having policies on guidance and including on publication on them, that we should refer to them in paragraph one. I think the best place to do that, and this would track the order of the recommendation in 2019, would be you'd put it right at the very end of the paragraph. Let me see if I can put it in the chat. And so I have no particular preferences about what's said, but I think that I just quoted, this is a direct quote from the 2019 public availability of guidance documents recommendations preamble. So something along this lines here in addition, OMB has also something along those lines.
Right. Okay. Okay, great. So it could start at that second sentence instead of at various times. It could be in addition. Or do you think that first sentence, elements of that first sentence are also valuable to put into the paragraph?
Sorry, I just I put that first sentence in just for a little context. I think, yeah.
Okay, got it.
I don't know whether in addition or something.
Or further. Okay. Okay. Great. So we will add the language and the style committee will ensure that the flow works, unless there's objections with respect to including that language. And any other comments on paragraph one? Okay, let's move forward to paragraph two, which is lines 9 through, I don't know if we'll get the second page as well. And I don't know, Ben, if it'd be possible to get the entire second paragraph.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I just wanted to mention. Yeah, so yeah, and then Jeff had the comment.
The first sentence
was not necessary. I think.
I see. Got suggestion. It. Got it. Okay. Thank you.
I try to do.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Okay. So thoughts on Jeff's suggestion to omit the first sentence. I mean, I could go either way in terms of whether it's omitted or not. And so since Jeff made the recommendation, I'll propose that we omit it and then see if there's any objections to the submission and then re-add it if there are. Okay. Yeah, I see what Jeff's saying. Yeah, it does seem repetitive from what we already described in the first paragraph. So other comments about paragraph 2, 9 through 17.
Suggest on line 10, delete the word also.
Okay. And make request, gotcha. Mm-hmm. There are no other comments, suggestions with respect to paragraph 2. We'll move forward to.
And so, yeah, sorry, Bertrand, just we referenced the addition of the footnote 3 related to like the title and the proper scope of the recommendation. We just wanted to make sure folks were okay with that addition since we
did. Oh, yeah. Thank you. So, looking to footnote 3, which was added to the recommendation since our last meeting. Yes, Shalini.
Sorry. So I think line 16 talks about the provision of individualized guidance is required by statute. And that's something that I intend to revise in the report. I think the best characterization is that it's authorized and the procedures are described by a statute, but I don't think it's that the agency in a given instance is obligated to write an advisory opinion. I mean, they have a lot of discretion in choosing. So I just don't know if that's accurate, accurate.
Thank you, Shalini. So these in some programs, the provisions of individualized guidance are, in some programs, statutes authorize the provision of individual guidance and prescribe procedures. Would that be accurate? Okay.
So could you just give it to me one more time?
This guidance is authorized by statute.
Right, or just authorized by statute. In some programs, the provision of individual guidance is authorized by statute. And do we want to say that authorized by statute? Do we want to say anything about how statutes prescribe procedures? That statutes do prescribe procedures for individual guidance, or do we think that that's necessary here? Having heard no real desire to add it, so we'll just keep it here as authorized by statute. And others agencies offer individual guidance on their own initiatives, public service. Okay. So just want to double check with Shalini in terms of that change from required to authorize. Would that satisfy your concerns about accuracy?
Yes.
Okay, thanks. Okay, so any other suggestions with respect to paragraph three or two, excuse me, 9 through 17? Okay, so let's move forward to paragraph three, which is 18 through 25. Yes, Bill.
I'm down in the, I guess, the line 21.
Okay.
Both Cellini's article or report and here refer to lower level staff. And it seemed like anybody below a senior official was staff. And that sort of disturbed me a little bit because there's people who are what I call inferior officers who are ones who I think are actually making these determinations. I know at the SEC it's referred to as staff, but the people who actually sign off on it, I think, have a title. I would change it by saying, I put it the other way around, start off this sentence by saying, some individualized guidance is prepared and issued by agency heads or other senior officials. And then while other individualized guidance is reviewed and issued by lower level officials.
Got it.
Is reviewed and issued. I don't know why we use reviewed prior, but reviewed and issued by law.
Should it be prepared and issued here as well?
Yeah, probably prepared is better than reviewed.
Yeah.
Lower level officials.
Officials, yeah.
And then, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I support that change to the recommendation. Any sort of comments or feedbacks or objections to that change?
Hey, just to clarify, because I was typing it back out, did you want to change prepared here to reviewed?
No, I think we want to keep prepared. Okay. Is that right? On both?
I guess the implication being agency heads might not prepare it.
Oh, I see.
Or senior officials.
I see.
Yeah, probably reviewed is better.
That makes sense. That makes sense. Okay. Any other comments on paragraphs 3, 18 through 26 now. Okay, so let's move forward to paragraph 4, which is lines 27 through 33. Any sort of comments or suggestions with respect to paragraph 4, 27, lines 27 through 33? Okay, so let's move forward to paragraph 5, lines 34 through 40. Any comments or suggestions with respect to paragraph 5, line 34 through 40? Yes, Kevin.
I don't know whether others, I just went and checked that it says it recommends, this is in, I can't tell exactly what line it is. Is that where we are here? This middle?
The ones that starts at the same time, that paragraph.
No, I'll hold off my comment. Sorry.
Okay, great. any comments on paragraph 5, lines 34 through 40? Let's move to paragraph 6. That starts these benefits and goes from lines 41 through 51. Yes, Kevin.
Yeah, sorry. So we say there in the middle of the paragraph, it recommends that agencies not treat individuals' guidance as creating binding standards. I think that, you know, we do say, and we had some discussion about this our first meeting, that recommendation 2 says agencies should not treat individualized guidance as creating standards. I don't know, something you just kind of, so we do recommend, yeah, so that's a recommendation there. It makes sense to me. I don't know, something bothers me about the idea that we're recommending agencies in the preamble. I have no objection to the language in number mm-hmm. 2, paragraph 2 here. We're right. recommending that agencies not do something that they would be legally prohibited from doing.
Okay.
But maybe that's just we do have very important point, but
yeah, I hear your point, Kevin. Yes, Bill.
I don't know. I mean. This whole paragraph is sort of summarizing what the recommendations do. And I sort of thought that the preamble did a pretty good job of generally summarizing the recommendations. But this is really for Kevin. I mean, did you find it didn't accurately reflect what the recommendation did? Or I agree, it just sort of reiterates it, but the idea is to distinguish between treating it as a binding standard and sometimes allowing for reliance. And I thought that sort of summary here was sort of helpful.
Yeah, I agree, Bill. It's useful, and so maybe I'll withdraw my point. Somehow it stuck me a little funny, but it's useful, and the preamble flows along well. So maybe I'll withdraw my suggestion.
Any other suggestions, which what I think is now, so what I think is paragraph 7, lines 41 through 31. Okay, so the final paragraph, paragraph 8, lines 52 through 55. It starts, this recommendation recognizes. Okay, and so just one last opportunity to for any comments on the preamble as a whole, any of the paragraphs, something that we may have sped by that you still wanted to comment on, here's your opportunity. Okay, so given that we have a little bit of time, I guess we could just walk through the first section of the recommendations, just looking to the changes that were made in light of after the first meeting, which is primarily to 1. We will add, a section or a recommendation here with respect to ombuds. To this individualized guidance generally at the bottom of it. So keep that in mind. That'll be added to as recommendation 6, I guess, now. But are there any sort of thoughts with respect to after Ben has a chance to add that bracket in? If there's any comments on the changes to recommendation 1 or any of the, yeah, I guess we'll just start with recommendation one at the top in terms of the changes.
Yeah, I think just to highlight the language is retained in track changes from the first committee meeting. The stylistic changes don't show up, but it was around this area, the just kind of simplified this. The key language is still there though from the first meeting, which was resources, priorities, and missions.
Okay, if there's no comments on that, I guess we'll go down to four. Just to
I think Matt may have said he had some edits on this, which you can send separately, or we can
That's right. So I will some edits to that. Okay.
But again, yeah, the substance is the same. We just
got it.
Tweak the style.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think that we're in a good place. I don't know if there are any other comments on this first section at all. We'll, of course, review the whole document during our last meeting. Just wanted to give any opportunities for comments so that the staff can make appropriate changes in advance of our next meeting. All right. I guess we'll close the document for now. And you know, we will make sort of the appropriate adjustments to the document as we go forward. Let me kind of remind in terms of my script, in terms of what I'm supposed to be saying right now. So just a reminder that we will be meeting again our third time to discuss individual guidance on Wednesday, May 1st. Our meeting is scheduled to be for 2 hours, 10 a.m. To 12 noon Eastern time. So we'll work through the preamble, the recommendations once again, and that'll be updated in light of the suggested changes that were made here. I just want to thank you all for your service and support for the individual guidance recommendation. It's been a really fruitful and productive conversation, as I feel like we've moved the ball forward quite a bit. So thanks to all of you. And I don't know if Andy has anything to say at the end to close us out.
Thanks, Petrella. Just thank you to you and to all the members of the committee for a very thoughtful discussion and set of amendments. We'll see you next time.
See you next time. And thanks to everyone. See you soon.
Thank you.